falling away to the Antichrist spirit. Now, Paul outlines two frightful things that will strike the church just prior to the Lord's coming. Paul said that Jesus will not come until these two awful things happen, and they're going to happen in the church. Two things. One, a great falling away, a great apostasy in the church. Secondly, a spirit of Antichrist overcoming many who are backsliding. A spirit of Antichrist possessing many who are in the church. Now, folks, for years we've been told that the coming Antichrist is coming. We're expecting a man, the son of perdition. Some have speculated that the man is possibly even born now, and that he's somewhere on the earth now and perhaps soon to take power. Now, is there such a thing as the Antichrist? I say yes, there is. He's going to come one day, and he's going to be well received, and I'll tell you why he's going to be well received. He's going to be well received even by many who are Christians, because they have been prepared for his coming.
The birth of evil was foretold. 1978, a terrifying prophecy was fulfilled. And now, you will witness the ultimate challenge to the future of mankind as the trinity of living terror is completed in the final conflict.
Yes, Mr. President.
I just appointed Mr. as our new ambassador to the court of St. James.
Attractive, brilliant, charismatic. To the modern world, he brings a purpose, a vision, a destiny. He's one step away from the most important position on earth.
Disciples of the watch, I stand before you in the name of the one who is cast out from heaven, but is alive. In me.
The power of evil is no longer in the hands of a child.
Preacher Joel Osteen, who lives in a $16 million house and drives a Ferrari.
And he's going to be revealed, and the only reason that he's not revealed now is it's not his time. The Holy Ghost is holding it back. But one day the Holy Ghost will lift his restraining hand, and this man will be revealed, and he will be incarnated by Satan. He will demand and be received by mankind. And when he's finished, the time is done. The Bible says he's going to be consumed by our holy God. But there is an Antichrist spirit, just as surely as there is a spirit of Jesus Christ that abides in us. The scripture says, because you are sons, he sends forth the spirit into your hearts that cry, Abba, Father. Now we have a Christ who is a man, now in glory. He has flesh, he has bone, hair, eyes. He's a living man because he still has his body. Even though he is God, he's a man in glory. And he is there and we are here, but his spirit is here. We are living through his spirit. I live not, but Christ lives in me. Who lives in me? The spirit of Christ. There's a man in me. Now, there's two Christs in the world, the Antichrist and Jesus Christ. Antichrist has a spirit just like Jesus. There's a spirit of Antichrist. That spirit is now moving in the world, preparing for the coming of the Antichrist. Just as sure as you as a believer have the spirit of Christ in you, there are people today who absolutely are possessed by the spirit of Antichrist. Now, I'm going to show you today, I hope, on how it's overpowering many churches. Some churches, believe it or not, are directed by the spirit of Antichrist. Paul warns that there's prophets who will come and preach another gospel and another Jesus, and the other Jesus is the Antichrist. There's going to be of the spirit of the Antichrist. There are going to be many apostate Christians in the last days who, while we've been looking for this man, Satan's been creeping.
I prayed about it, and I thought, I'm not missing that dedication in Jerusalem. I'm not missing that dedication in Jerusalem.
Satan operates 99% of the time in false religion.
Oh,
I'm telling you, it was so strong in me and on me. Just the spirit of God and judgment over this thing. Just bring judgment down on this thing. And it was so strong in me. I don't know how to explain that. Just that prophetic anointing and just fury at this thing. I spoke judgment on it.
People will comment to me all the time, Justin, there's just something about his eyes, something about Kenneth Copeland's eyes. And you know what? I wholeheartedly agree. I have said the same thing for years. And I'm going to be very clear. I don't know that I've said this on video before, but I have said it in a letter, in an email that I wrote to Michael Brown. I gave him full permission to read it on his program, and he did. I truly believe, without any hint of hyperbole, that Kenneth Copeland is demon-possessed.
Our deliverance. Heat. This virus hates heat. 80, 90 degrees up, you just burn this thing. Burn it. Man, it's hot. Do you guys notice how hot it was driving over here tonight? I mean, boy, I mean, right here, you know, come on, man, the second day of April. Who ever heard of such a thing? Being 80, 90 degrees in April. Man, dear God. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Man, it's hot in this building tonight. Huh? Come on.
Kenneth Copeland, you talk about bizarre. You don't have a God in you. You are one. Don't be disturbed when people accuse you of thinking you're God. Pray to yourself. You have the same creative faith and ability on the inside of you that God used when He created the heavens and the earth. Yeah, just create your own little universe for you to live in. Your own little fantasy world. Kenneth Copeland said, God is a being that stands somewhere around 6'2" tall. There's a high view of God for you. He said, I don't preach doctrine. Well, we believe you on that. I mean, we're walking forward on that one. I don't preach doctrine, I preach faith. Yeah, faith in yourself and faith in the devil. Kenneth Hagin says, the believer is as much an incarnation as was Jesus Christ. Fred Price in this town says, have a Rolls Royce faith. And Benny Hinn says, are you ready for some real revelation knowledge? You are God. He said, Christians are little messiahs. Christians are like gods. He said, never, ever, ever go to the Lord and say, if it be thy will. He said, we Christians possess power in our mouths to heal or kill just as witches possess it. He said, we are little messiahs, everything that Jesus ever was.
I call for a strong south wind. I call for a strong high pressure system. I call for a supernatural heat wave all over this nation and anywhere else in the world where it is needed. I speak to this atmosphere.
Joel Osteen, in a sermon entitled Miracles in Your Mouth, he says, our words have creative power. When we speak something out, we're giving it the right to come to pass. There is healing in your mouth. The miracle is in your mouth. So whatever you want, you just need to speak it. It's all up to you. Speak it into existence. This is a New Age book, titled Supreme Influence, subtitle, Change Your Life with the Power of the Language You Use. Nothing Christian about this book. It's New Age, does not pretend to be Christian. Now, for comparison, let me show you a quote-unquote Christian book by Joyce Meyer. Change your words, change your life, understanding the power of every word you speak. You see, it's the same thing. This is not Christian. This is cultic. Cultic doctrine wrapped in some Christian lingo. to make it appear to be Christian when it in fact is not.
It's going to get so hot in New York City. It's going to get so hot and muggy. It's going to hit that place, glory to God, and it's going to burn that virus. It's going, you know what it's like in New York City at 85 or 90 degrees. It's going to get however hot it has to get there to kill that thing right now. All over this nation and the rest of the world where it's needed.
Doesn't that just give you the heebie-jeebies?
Burn!
God taught me by the Holy Spirit how to start confessing the Word of God out loud and calling things that were not yet a reality in my life as if they already existed.
Wrong. We know there are people who are in this movement who are deceivers, and they know they're deceivers. They're false teachers, and they know they're false teachers. They're in it for the money, and they know they're in it for the money.
I was talking to my friend Justin Peters, who has for years been sort of beating the drum of the dangers that we face because of this prosperity gospel. And Justin and I were talking about the fact that basically in America, we have prosperity gospel junior, where I've been living for the last 2.5 years in sub-Saharan Africa. That's prosperity gospel senior, and it is horrid. There are churches in our region where people under the leadership of their pastor have crawled around on hands and knees eating grass, others drinking gasoline, handing over their wives to have sex with pastors and elders because they've been told that this will open up the womb and finally give them children. And in light of this, there is this need to sort of push back darkness, to stand against falsehood and preserve and proclaim the gospel, to get the gospel right. Amen?
So I'm going to give them food from above. Happy we are fasting, but they're going to eat the fulfillment from above. Wake up! Stand up! Stand up! Upright! Attention! Close your mouth! Okay, I see food outside. Look at that. Look at that food. Be quiet. Be quiet. Okay, go and eat. Go and eat. Go eat outside. Go, quickly. Eat quickly. Eat quickly. Today, no time, no time. You eat quickly. Limited time today.
I'm telling you, you take one step off of sola scriptura and you have put your foot on a theological banana peel. You are on a slippery slope. It is inevitable. You are headed down, down, down until you crash at the bottom.
the most serious crimes ever committed against God are committed in corrupt worship. That takes us to the point where we need to say the charismatic movement continually dishonors God in its false forms of worship. It dishonors the Father, it dishonors the Son, but most specifically, it dishonors the Holy Spirit. Irreverent ideas, irreverent actions, untrue beliefs, false claims, false promises, fleshly behaviors, all these things are attributed to the Holy Spirit, but they are a dishonor to Him that they would even be identified with His name. It's more strange fire, and the sad thing is it's ground for judgment. It's ground for judgment. When I was talking about this some months ago to our church, I said, it's this severe. Jesus said to the Jewish leaders, you have attributed the works of the Holy Spirit that I've done to Satan. In other words, they said Jesus did what He did by the power of Satan, Matthew 12, and He said, you've attributed the works of the Holy Spirit to Satan. It's fair to say that the reverse is happening in many places in the charismatic movement. They are attributing to the Holy Spirit the works of Satan. Once they attributed to Satan the works of the Holy Spirit, now it's reversed.
Music empire, charismatic, young, and fashionable leaders and celebrity attendees from Justin Bieber to Chris Pratt. But it's why Hillsong has grown into one of the most influential megachurches in the world and one of the most controversial.
Then Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, each took his censer and put fire in it, put incense on it, and offered profane fire before the Lord, which He had not commanded them. So fire went out from the Lord and devoured them, and they died. Whatever was in this fire that made it strange, or whatever was in this fire that were offered by the sons of Aaron that made it profane, it did not please God. These young priests were simply involved in experimental worship, maybe to try to change the liturgy that God had ordained in such a way that would be more appealing to the congregation. They missed the fundamental principle of worship, is that worship is to be determined not by what is pleasing to us, but what is pleasing to God. The most successful worship service ever recorded in the Bible was found in the Old Testament that drew more people in attendance, broke all attendance records, and the singing was so full of gusto that when the voices of the singers was heard miles away on a mountain, one of the men who heard the noise of this celebration, of this singing, thought a war had broken out and thought that the noise that he was hearing was the tumult that accompanies battle. But when he took time to investigate it, it was not a war. It was a worship service with a golden calf. Nothing attracts greater crowds than the practices of idolatry.
And a masuko radiaste kaya. And a me fiesto po. And a mamamoru vieste. And a manjukura televia. And sakara diesto kora. Ey boya. Ey ha. Woo! Previa tala. Many in sukura de.
Yes, your course for more spicy, spicy, sizzly, juicy, juicy. Be sure with the hot seat, see? Greensburg.
Kind of give you just a few items here dealing in a general nature with the gift of tongues. We've already discussed tongues are not unique to Christianity. Many Hindus speak in tongues. Some Buddhists speak in tongues. Even a few Muslims, if you can believe that, speak in tongues. A lot of Roman Catholics speak in tongues. So it's not unique to Christianity. Pagans do it too. Tongues can be practiced in an ignorant, ungodly way. Tongues can be practiced in such a way that it brings attention to the person speaking in tongues rather than glorifying Christ and edifying his church. And this is what was going on in the church of Corinth. In the church of Corinth, Paul, on a second missionary journey, came to the city of Corinth, completely pagan city. He preached the gospel, a number of people were saved, and Paul started a church there. And he spent about a year and a half with these new believers, trying to grow them up and mature them. And when he felt like they could handle things on their own, Paul then left them and went to other destinations to preach the gospel. Well, Paul may have left a little bit too soon, because he got word later from a lady back in Corinth named Chloe, and Chloe informed the Apostle Paul that things had gone awry in the church in Corinth, that there was a group of people within this church who had become very arrogant in their exercise of the spiritual gifts. And it had almost become a contest between them as to who could prove themselves to be the most spiritual. Well, I'm more spiritual than you are because I speak in tongues more than you do. I have the gift of healing more strongly than you do. Look at me. Look how spiritual I am. And they even gave themselves a name. They called themselves the pneumatikoi, which in the Greek means the spirituals. And because of this arrogance, all manner of sin and immorality crept into the church, and it just about destroyed the church from the inside out. I mean, they had all kinds of stuff going on in the church in Corinth. Their arrogance was self-aggrandizing. They were trying to bring attention to themselves. And one of the things that they used was speaking in unintelligible, ecstatic gibberish, what charismatics today call tongues.
None left empty. None left sick. None left bound.
There's glory on that man here! Come on, sing it, choir! Come on, sing it, choir! Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this house. Pick up this man, bring him here.
Right.
I blow the wind of God.
The wind of God.
On you.
I can't tell you how profoundly serious this movement is, how corrupting it is. And what grieves me and concerns me is the absence of any real rising effort of men to join the battle and say, look, souls are at stake here. This is a deadly, deadly movement. This is the perfect storm to give people false security, false assurance that they're Christians when they're not. And if we have any responsibility, it is to make sure that people who aren't Christians don't think they are.
It seems to me that always the devil works it out so that the great assumption is they're saved. The least amount of time, it seems eventually, is given to discerning what is the gospel and whether a person is truly saved. If they just walk up front and they pray that prayer, we declare them saved and start discipling them. We should maybe be working with this person for months that they come to a biblical assurance. And so our churches are filled with lost people, and it's by and large because the superficiality of pastors. And most of them have gone to church growth schemes and turned their church into Six Flags Over Jesus, and they no more are preaching the gospel than a man on the moon.
4. Certain people have crept in unnoticed, who long beforehand were designated for this condemnation. Well, that's not very nice. It gets worse. ungodly people. How about that? You're ungodly and you're condemned. He'd get a letter from some of these people who write me. Dear Jude, you're not nice. And I don't think the gospel can be effective if you go around talking about condemnation and calling people ungodly. Signed, the person who thinks I know more than the Holy Spirit who led you to write this. What do? They pervert the grace of God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ. There's two things that they do. They pervert grace and they deny Christ. That's why, although I was going to write to you about our common salvation, I felt the necessity to deviate here and address this issue. Why? Because if we don't get this issue taken care of, salvation's in jeopardy. Not in the sense that somebody who's saved is going to lose their salvation, but in this sense. If we pervert the grace of God and we deny Christ, there is no gospel, which means we must contend. Why? Because we love lost people and we want them to hear the truth. And so we contend with those who pervert the truth.
I've just for years and years since I've been saved, have just looked at the rock solid ministry of Kenneth Copeland.
When I read in the Bible where he says, I am, I just smile and say, yes, I am too.
I am dangerous. You understand that?
Yes, sir, I do.
I am spiritually lethal, brother.
That's right. I'm so glad you're on our team.
Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles? But I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers.
You see, the Antichrist is not going to just suddenly appear on the scene and overcome mankind. He's not going to come and just try to influence people right away by saying, hey, I'm here and worship me. No, that spirit's already working in some people who are falling away and in the world. And so that when he gets here, he's going to be accepted very simply, very easily. When he is ready to be revealed, hearts will already be ready for his coming. Now, why would some Christians backslide and return to the Antichrist? It's because they're of his spirit. They're like-minded. And he is now in the world preparing hearts to receive him when he comes. And there are some sitting here now, believe it or not, who, if the Antichrist is revealed right now, would probably quickly, openly receive him, because you've already been receiving the Antichrist spirit in you and it has been preparing you and you've already been accepting it. There's iniquity already in work. It's already at work. The spirit of Antichrist says the spirit of Antichrist is already at work. He's already moving. He's already taking position. He's already coming into power. I want you to go to 1 John, please. Second chapter, 1 John 2:15. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but it is of the world.